industry leaders, where they share their professional wisdom for the benefit of our subscribers, who are typically the young audience, aged 13 years to 25 and above. Thank you so much, Mrs. Anjali Aggarwal, for your time today. It's been a privilege to know your life experiences.
Thank you for inviting me here.
Guide us a bit about your journey from your school and college days.
I am the daughter of an army officer, and I was the youngest of three. My elder brother and sister both went to boarding school in those days. My father was quite fond of me and didn't feel like parting with me, as he said, so he never sent me to boarding school, and I was homeschooled till the age of 10. Unfortunately, at the age of 10, my father passed away, and so we moved to a small town in Bihar, the capital actually. I wouldn't call it a small town, but at that time it was a small town. And I was admitted in a school directly in class 4. Since I was homeschooled prior to that, I loved my school. It was St. Joseph's Convent High School. I studied there and enjoyed my school days thoroughly. I was never one of the top students, but never was I also at the bottom of the class. So school days were fun. I remember playing all sorts of games, even though I'm not very good in all physical activities, but I played all games, and most of all, I loved reading. And I feel that this is what has made me what I am today, my love for reading. Higher education, I went for some time to Patna Women's College. I admitted that due to financial difficulties, I couldn't continue with my education over there. So I continued privately.
Okay.
I took up a job to help bring the bread into the family.
That's great.
And continued with the rest of my education privately. And I don't feel that in any way that has made me any less than what I am. I completed all my qualifications, and I love literature, I love poetry, I love theatre. And English language is, of course, my forte.
Did you always want to become an educator?
Not really.
Okay. What all passions or the choice of professions you had, like all youngsters had, before the zoning on one particular profession? What were the choices you were exploring?
I wanted to become a librarian.
Okay.
I was so much in love with books. The very idea of living amongst books, all from morning till evening, was something which fascinated me. And my second choice was to work in a bookshop. So it all revolved around my love for reading. But then I realized, with the passage of time, that just reading is not enough.
Okay.
Reading, getting to know things, learning more about the world, other people's thoughts, stories, adventures, autobiographies. There's so much you learn, but then there's so much also more you have to return. You have to return back to society. If I feel that I have been able to instill this love of reading in even 20% of my students, I will feel I'm blessed.
And that's a great message, ma'am, to implement the learnings and to disseminate information we learn from the books.
Not necessarily only from the books. Okay. There's life to learn from too.
Yes, ma'am.
Books are just one part of it.
True, true.
We learn from each other.
Yes.
There are people who we are impressed with.
Yes, ma'am.
The people who we make our heroes.
Yes, ma'am.
And we learn to walk in their footsteps.
Absolutely. Do you believe there is a change which has happened while you were in school to what the education is nowadays? As if yes, a couple of key changes, ma'am?
Yes, of course. Certain things haven't changed, but certain things have changed a lot. When people have changed, when the atmosphere of the world has changed, the exposure which every child is getting,
yes,
has changed. So naturally, schooling also has to change.
Okay.
The person who doesn't change with times is a person who ceases to grow. And the same thing is with education. If we don't change, we don't, like, if we didn't have technology when I was growing up.
Right.
So, does that mean that technology will not be part of my school? It will be part of my school, and we didn't have so many sports. But now there's so much exposure to so many games, to to so many different things. We never had a model United Nations in my school days. Does that mean that we're not going to have it today? What has happened with one does not mean that it will happen to others. And we have to grow and change with the times.
Your life experiences, has there been a mentor which has influenced you professionally?
So many. I feel that I have learned from so many people. There are just a few whom I'd like to comment upon.
Sure.
There was a gentleman by the name of Mr. Shakir.
Okay.
He had retired from the Department of Education. And in the beginning years of my school, when my school was just, we were very young, just a 1-year-old or 2-year-old school, he would come and he would often advise me. And I realized that that gentleman had a lot of knowledge. It just needed somebody to ask him to take his advice. And I benefited a lot from all the advice he used to give. And that made me realize that every person has a lot to give. And when you realize that everyone has some wisdom to give you, and just be open to accept it, just be accepting. Of course, listen to everyone, but decide what you have to do by yourself.
Should school students also have a mentor, apart from their parents who are the best mentor and followed by the teachers? Should they also explore mentors and role models?
I believe in that. We have a system in our school of which the pass outs, that is the old students, they do come a few times in a year and talk with the students. They come into the classroom and you talk with them, talk to them about how their school days were and what they did after school and what they are doing now and what the journey has been.
Right.
So you see, these people are listened to more than teachers or parents.
Right.
Teachers and parents are basically your authoritative figures.
Right.
And there is somebody who's been in the same, who sat in the very same class, maybe sat on the very same bench, and now has his advice to give to you. So those people are listened to better. So I feel that this sort of mentoring by our ex-students has really proved a boon to my students.
Okay. Were you in any leadership role when you were in school days?
I'm afraid not. I was one of those naughty ones who used to sit at the back of the class and try to talk with my friends when nobody was around, when the teacher wasn't paying attention. But that's about it. But I loved to be part. It's not necessary to be a leader during school days to not to take up a leadership role later.
What are the one or two key skills you look at while hiring beyond the academic credentials?
Naturally. When I hire primary teachers,
okay,
I look for a smile.
Okay.
Amongst other qualities, enthusiasm, communicative skills, communication skills, and of course, a love for children, I look for a smile on the face. Because I feel that young children should be always surrounded by happy people. Okay. Happiness makes you more accepting, more receptive.
Yeah.
And a teacher who can make her entire class happy has definitely taught much more than the teacher who went to class with her head stuffed with knowledge but didn't have a smile on her face. This is for primary teachers.
Okay.
Now for teachers, of course, I would still continue hoping for the smile even in senior classes. But of course, here, when I interview teachers, it's a three stages each teacher passes through before being selected as a teacher over here.
Okay.
First, of course, is the interview.
Right.
How the teacher, he or she, is able to communicate with you and impress you with his or her knowledge.
Right.
Usually, I try to call experts in the subject to be part of the panel of interviewers. The second thing is a written test. There are some people who can impress you with their knowledge and are unable to really write a paper as they would expect a student to write a paper. So we have a written test in which the teachers are tested in. And finally, the third stage is a demonstration class.
Social media is an asset or a liability nowadays for the school-going children. And if it is an asset, how they should treat it, and if it's a liability, what they should not do.
The first thing we have to realize is that social media cannot be ignored.
Absolutely.
It cannot be ignored. So, when something cannot be ignored, you cannot remove it from your life. Use it to the best possible, in the best possible way.
Okay.
Instead of just surfing aimlessly,
right,
it should be utilized properly. And I'm not saying that children shouldn't use the social media. If it has to be used, it has to be used, but judiciously.
So they should use it in their projects and in their real work assignments.
Absolutely. But that doesn't mean that they should forget about writing themselves. Because now what is happening,
yes,
is children are so used to the, what's it, Facebook lingo or the texting lingo,
yes,
that they forget how, they have forgotten how to write properly. So in school, we must make sure the children write the proper spellings and the proper, they have to clearly demarcate that this is acceptable on the social media, but when you're writing an answer for a paper, what language you should be using.
It's true, because it reflects when they become a professional, the email etiquette, there's no course in email etiquette.
Absolutely.
The vocabulary goes towards that.
But right now, CBSE is trying to give you, as part of the English syllabus,
okay,
the children have to learn how to write a proper email too.
That's very helpful for everyone. In your professional life, has there been a couple of challenges? If yes, how did you overcome those challenges?
Running a school is a challenge every day. Because every day you have to do something better than what you did yesterday.
Right.
And if you're not going to progress, your school is going to stagnate. And you'll be able to live on reflected glory for a little while, but there'll come a time when your school will downside. So, it's every day a challenge. And the most important thing as far as parents is concerned is that treat them as your friends. Because teachers and parents together have to work for the welfare of their children. When teachers start feeling that parents do not cooperate, and parents start feeling that the teacher isn't good for some reason or the other,
right,
it just needs communication channels to be opened.
Okay.
This is just what I very genuinely say, but it's important for parents to feel that they are part of the institution also. I have a small program known as Wonderful Wednesdays.
Wonderful Wednesdays.
Yes. This is one day in the week when the junior children, we invite the parents or the grandparents to volunteer to come for half a day to the school and be part of the institution, maybe teaching yoga, maybe helping in some craft work. We allow the parent to become a teacher for one period. So it's a wonderful Wednesday. And it's for the little ones. It's mainly for the children of class 1 and 2. And we feel that parents have realized the challenges which a teacher has.
Once they step into the shoes.
Yes. Of course, we give all support.
Yes.
And the parents are very happy to volunteer, but they realize and they appreciate the teachers more. And so that the teachers also develop a better relationship and a rapport with the parents.
One suggestion which you have for all the parents of school-going children, for something which they should do every day, to impact the child's performance and to empower the teachers as well as the overall outcome of education?
I would say this to parents, that life is a journey and so is school education. It's a journey right from class 1 to class 12, and there is no particular rule to be followed which you can follow in class 1 and also follow in class 12.
Okay.
Because children change. The education system is changing. So accordingly, your responses also have to change. I have just in fact held a parent orientation program today, and this is what I told the parents, that when your child was in grade 1 or 2, you were the hero of your child, in your child's life.
Right.
Whatever papa said, whatever mama said, was the truth. Now your children have come to grade 8 and 9. All of a sudden, you are no longer the center of their universe. Their friends have become the center of their universe. So, your parenting style also has to change. Right from grade 1, what your parenting style was in grade 1, it will not be the same in grade 6. And what it was in grade 6, it will not be the same in grade 12. So, parents have to realize that as their children change, so their parenting styles have to change. But the most important thing which every parent should do is first both parents should have a united front.
Okay.
Children are very intelligent. They can easily play one parent against the other.
Okay.
So they should have a united front. And the second is to grow along with your child. Don't be a permissive parent. Don't be too rigid a parent.
Okay.
Strike a middle balance. And there may be times when your child says to you, look at my friend's mother. She allows so many things and you do not allow it. Do not try to follow somebody else. You are an individual. Be the person your child loves. Every parent has his or her own parenting style. They should see to it that they change according to the requirement of the child. But at no point of time should parents make the child the reason of their existence. When parents start parents' lives start revolving around the child, I feel the child does not know what to do with that importance. Family is an entity, a unit, which comprises of parents and children, maybe grandparents and uncles too, uncles and aunts. But everyone has their importance. Nobody's role is more important than the other. And when children realize that they are part of a family, they are part of a group, and they are not the son.
That's wonderful suggestions. I as a parent also value that suggestion for my daughters.